not really going to manage to do what Stephen said at the beginning, although I find it much easier to have a poem come out from my body. I enjoy that much more, but I'm going to try and talk a little bit. And it's in a frail way because it's been a strange couple of weeks of not finding things, which in the end I felt was sort of appropriate to Peter Handke in this country, and also that frailty that I love from his sort of metaphysical time that you talked about so beautifully. But I'm not going to do a performance like you did so beautifully also. So it's a sort of collage of quotes. I was looking for this essay for about 10 days and I could not find it. And I walk into the room and it's there on the table, which is actually beautiful. This is a translator, Peter Handke. If Handke had a master teacher, maybe it was his fellow Austrian, Wittgenstein, with his radical rejection of imposed philosophical systems and his stubborn pursuit of the minutest detail of habitual responses and casual speaking patterns. Handke had a Slovenian mother, which had been that fact has been referred to, and somehow in the back of all my thoughts I was trying to get back to the text of repetition, which I also could not find. I could not find my 30-year-old translation of repetition, which you've repeated there, which is great. But on my way here, I suddenly also realised that what I should have done was brought a translation I've recently done of the Slovenian writer Florian Libuš, his novel about the partisans in Carinthian Austria, which of course is where Anka's family in part came from, because that would have been so appropriate. But of course I left it behind. It didn't occur to me, and the frame of it. Because the Second World War at that time was so bloody, so appalling, like all wars. And that text of Libuš, just like Maya Hadalov's wonderful novel that was translated last year or 2 years ago, again about partisans and their struggle against Nazism, Austria-Slovenian borderland. This is Philip Gobal. The narrator recalls how his mother, in repetition, whenever speaking of her Slovenian homeland, recite the names of the major towns of Lipica, Temnica, Vipava, Doboldob, Tomaj, Tabor, Kopriva. And I read that and I suddenly remembered Doboldob, and I thought back, that was the appalling battle in 1917. And I thought back, on one side there was Preživo Volanč, great Slovenian novelist who wrote the novel Doboldob. And on the other side was Carlo Emilio Gadda, wonderful Italian novelist who wrote superb wartime journals and prison journals from 1915 to 1919. I'm sorry I'm rambling, but I want to ramble. I want to ramble across the border. It's all about our getting lost. This is Gobal, wandering across the Karst Mountains with an old Slovenian dictionary as his travel companion. Time and again I applauded the epic of words, and I laughed as well, not the laughter of ridicule, but the laughter of recognition and complicity. Yes, there is a word for the bright spot in the cloudy sky, a word for the way an ox runs back and forth on a hot day when he's stung by a horsefly, a word for flames suddenly bursting from a stove, a word for the juice of stewed pears, for the star on a bull's forehead, for a man on all fours extracting himself from the snow. Say such things, that he knew what partisans were, and he knew the brutality of partisans and of war, and the fratricide. And then I was looking for this essay. By Max Sebald, but of course this essay by Max Sebald is much easier to find, and it's about Handke's play Kaspar. Now Sebald wrote this in 1975, incidentally, which is 20 years before he ever became known as a fiction or so-called fiction writer. So I'm just going to read two or three little extracts from this essay, which I know he will not mind me doing, and I know his translator, who is also a good friend of mine, will not mind my doing. When, after several panic-stricken attempts, Kaspar emerges on stage from behind the backdrop of a curtain, and at first does not move from the spot in that strange space, he is the incarnation of astonishment. The theme of the play then is not the fast-moving adventures of the comic character, which are happily resolved in the end, but the inner and inward-looking story of the taming of a wild human being. The transformation of an unruly clowning into a proper Kaspar play, Punch and Judy play. The attempt, in many ways a hopeless one, to turn an individual who by ordinary standards is uncivilized. Who the hell's uncivilized in this world, in this city? Into a respectable citizen. You are deeply uncivilized, surely. Respectable citizens. I wanted to find door springs open, the skin springs open, the match burns, the slap burns, the grass trembles, the fearful girl trembles, the snap in the face smacks, the body smacks, the tongue licks, the flame licks, the saw screeches, the torture victim screeches, the lark trills, the policeman's whistle trills, the blood stops, the breath stops. And then the final sentence of Max Sebald's first essay on Peter Handke: when we write, we can transcend only by keeping faith with unsocial, banned language and by learning to use the opaque images of broken rebellion as a means of communication. Thank you for putting up with my mutterings.